if you are referring to the listener, it is second person you. So if you are referring to you, or if you are referring to you as part of a group, you refer to yourself as we. So when you use we, I, or you, it means it's deitic, deitic reference. That means the reference is to either the speaker or the listener. So in the context of pronouns, we take the second case, that is anaphoric reference. So when you use he, she, or they, the listener is supposed to know the reference, whom you are referring to by using he, whom you are referring to by using she. That's what you mean by anaphoric reference. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
I think we will continue with the TTP. And we have also seen the empty category PRO. It can be anaphoric, it can be pronominal. Sometimes the reference is outside the local domain. Someone tell me which text. It is syntax text, block 5. I think you were absent yesterday. I don't know how to be able to connect it to how be able to connect these ideas if you didn't attend the earlier class.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Okay. So we were discussing pronominals, and we saw that according to principle B, a pronominal must be free in its local domain. That means it should not have any antecedent within its local domain. Look at the sentence, I heard him. Him was a reference outside the local domain because him doesn't refer to I. I is the antecedent and hurt is the verb. So we have an antecedent there, but the reference is not to the antecedent. But in the case of anaphor, the reference must be within the local domain. But in these sentences, except those sentences which are marked false, all the references are outside the local domain. Okay. Again, the last point is deitic pronouns also conform to the principle B of the binding tree. Of course, when you refer to I or you don't need to include the reference inside the local domain because the speaker or the listener understands whom you are referring to. Okay. So that also follows second principle, that is, the reference must be outside the local domain. But only thing is that when you use a pronoun like he or she, unless the speaker doesn't know that who that he or she is, you have to add an additional sentence. Okay. So that must not be used within the local domain, but you can use another sentence, a separate sentence, whereby you can explain who that he is. For example, Ram is my friend. He is very smart. So he is a reference to Ram, because I have already used the sentence Ram, and I have taken the reference outside the local domain when I use another sentence with the pronoun he. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we have also seen the empty category PRO. Sometimes it can be a controller. It can have a controller, especially for a non-finite clause. See, non-finite clause cannot assign case to case to a subject. Okay, so it cannot take a subject of its own. So usually it takes reference from the finite clause. This also we have discussed. And someone asked me what is case filter. That yesterday I think I told you that filters are those verbs which usually assign case to noun. But in your textbook, in page number, I think somewhere it is in page number 39, there is something marked case filter. And towards that case filter, you can see a sentence, noun phrase, if the noun phrase does not have a syntactic case. Someone asked me what it is. Instead, I think I couldn't explain it well. Explanation is, see, noun phrase is not a noun phrase if the noun phrase does not have any syntactic case. That means the noun phrase can be called a noun phrase only if it has a case. Can be a nominative case, can be an accusative case, can be any of these cases, accusative, dative, or genitive case, but the only thing is that the noun phrase should have a case. So that means a noun phrase cannot exist in a sentence without being assigned a case. Is it clear? Hello?
Hello?
Ma'am, will you please repeat it?
Yes, ma'am.
Case filter means noun phrase, the noun phrase is not a noun phrase if it is not assigned a case. It's part of case theory. Usually these case filters are verb. As you know, a finite verb can assign case to a subject, or it can also give assign case to an object. When it is the object, it is accusative case. When the noun phrase is the subject, it is nominative case, as you all know. So this case theory says that a noun phrase cannot exist in a sentence without being assigned a case. Noun phrase is not a noun phrase if it is not given a case. That means every noun phrase in a sentence must bear a case. Can be nominative case, can be accusative case, let the case be any, but only thing is that it should be given a case. Okay?
Okay.
Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So usually these finite verbs assign case, but in case of non-finite, they can't assign case to subject. So the reference will be usually taken from the main clause. I want to go home. The reference for PRO is the subject of the main clause I. I want me to go home. So you can see that the reference is out. So the reference is outside the local domain, isn't it so? Isn't it so? So, at the first and sentence, two second sentences have a kind of controller. You can't say I or Sita to be. You can't call I or Sita as antecedent. Rather, we call them controllers. Usually, it can exist without a controller or a governor. But when it has a controller, that means it follows the second principle, that is principle B. A pronominal must have the reference outside the local domain. But in the second and but in the third and fourth example, that it's an empty PRO. That means reference is within the local domain, because pro to err is human means the reference is to everyone. Okay. I have told you about this PRO. It is a unpronounced but an understood empty category. The C and D. That means the sentences C and D uses for PRO, which is an understood and unpronounced category. It's a general maxim. To err is human. The reference is to everyone. The reference is to human beings. Okay? Hello? Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay, ma'am.
I think we have stopped until this one, empty category PRO. Did I discuss this? Other empty categories? I don't remember. Okay. So just now we saw the capital PRO, that is the empty category PRO, or otherwise it can be called an unpronounced but an understood category. Okay. Generally, it is related, generally, it can be applicable to everyone. It is generally applicable to each and every one of us. Let us look at the other kind of PRO, the small PRO. It occurs in imperative sentences. Imperative sentences means sentences which are in the form of order, command, request. So the addressee will be the, who is the addressee in an imperative sentence? The second person, you, right? I'm not getting any response. What happened to you?
Not audible, ma'am.
Am I not audible?
Yes, you are audible.
No.
Okay. So, okay, fine. See, when I don't get any response, I feel like I have lost my net connection. And that's why I'm asking you in between whether I'm audible, whether you are listening to me like that. Okay, we'll continue. So here I'm going to discuss this small letter PRO, small PRO. That means it is again another PRO pronoun, which is an understood category. But there is a slight difference between the capital PRO and the small PRO. So it occurs in imperative sentences whereby the addressee is the second person, you. But here, quite unlike the other PRO, this PRO comes in governed positions. Earlier, we saw that the capital PRO doesn't have a governor or an antecedent. Rather, it can have a controller, and it is also not always necessary. It can occur without a controller or a governor. But in the case of the small PR, there should be a governor. Okay, it is governed by the inflectional verb. It is governed by the verb. That is what is different between the small PRO and the capital PRO. The small PRO is governed, or rather comes in a governed position. Look at the sentence, close the door. Close the door. It can be an order. Okay, close the door. If there is please, could have been a request. Close the door, it's an order. So has it got a subject? Close the door. Has it got a subject?
No, ma'am.
There is a subject, but here also it imperative. Is an unpronounced. It's an imperative sentence. The subject is there, but again, you don't need to use it because it's an understood category. Unpronounced and understood category PRO. Only thing is that here it has got a governor. So close is a finite verb which controls or which governs the subject here. So the subject is you, right? Imperative sentences are addressed to the second person, you.
Yes, ma'am.
So close the door has got a subject, you, that is small PRO. And again, you can see that it agrees with the verb. Because since you is second person, the verb again uses its present tense form, close. You can't say that closes the door, because closes means it comes with third person singular. But in case of an imperative sentence, the verb must be in its plural form. Plural form means a verb without S form. Okay, so here I use close the door just because the subject is you. So we can say that you is controlled by the verb. So the verb is the governor for the subject you. That's why it is written PRO to second person. That is singular. Isn't it so? PRO to can be, that is pronoun, second person pronoun can be singular or plural. That you can be singular or plural, right? Are you able to decipher the symbols PRO to ST plural? Second person pronoun, if that is you, can be singular or plural. The agreement is again second person singular or plural verb. So for a second person singular or plural you, the verb should also be close. The verb should be in its plural form. Plural form means close. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay, so pro second person plural, which can be singular or plural, takes the it agrees with the verb from verb form singular plural. That means the singular or plural form of the verb for you is close. That's why we have the sentence close the door. Again, it acts like a pronominal, isn't it so? Here it is bound by the, it has got a governor. It is close is the governor here, and the reference is outside the local domain. You refers to the second person, which is not referred within the local domain. So it acts like a pronominal. Clear? But in the other capital PRO category, we saw that it is not governed all the time. It doesn't have a governor. But in the case of small PRO, it is always governed because it's got a finite verb. So the finite verb is the governor. So the subject will be in accordance with the verb. Like, let's take the second sentence. Hope everything is fine with you. Hope everything is fine with you. So who hopes everything is fine with you?
I.
So the subject is I. That's why it is written. First person singular is the subject there. PRO. PRO is pronoun. That small PRO here is the first person singular I. That agrees with hope. I hope everything is fine with you. Is that clear?
The yes, ma'am. Is,
what Ram do? It's a question. He sold off all his books. I didn't use subject just because the question was, the reference was already, there is an antecedent in the question itself. What did Ram do? So the answer is
sold off all his books. So who's the subject there?
Ram.
Subject. So the form is, the format is pro-ex, that is third person singular. Third person singular is he. Then inflectional past agreement, third person singular. Inflectional past form is sold. If it is present tense, you could have used sells. Since it is past tense, you use the past tense form of the verb, that is past form of agreement, again is third person singular. We can't express it in a sentence. You don't have any explicit expression for a third person singular past in its form. But if it is present, you could have used cells. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
In all these sentences, we saw this empty category, another empty category, PRO. But here, it comes in a governed position. That is the difference between empty category, capital PRO, and empty category, small PRO. I hope it is clear to you now. It is always governed. The small PR is always governed. It always comes in governed positions. Okay? And its reference is outside the local domain. You don't find the reference within the local domain. So it acts like pronominal. Okay? Is it
yes, ma'am.
Now we are moving on to the next important empty category. We have seen capital empty category, capital PRO, then empty category, small PRO. Now the third one is empty category, noun phrase trees. Earlier we have seen the subject to subject raising. Do you remember that? Subject to subject raising, whereby we have raised Ram to subject position and it replaced the dummy it. Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
The same is applicable here. See, Ram seems to be tired. From the deep structure, it seems Ram is tired. We have got the surface structure. Ram seems to be tired. Then look at the PRO there. The empty category PRO is in noun phrase trees. TX. TX is? What does the TX mean? What does it mean, the TX? What is a TX?
Remember, it is a left out portion.
It is a trace of the noun phrase Ram, right? So when Ram is moved to the subject position of the main clause, we can see that it leaves only the trace and it's part of the non-finite because it has already taken tense along with it. So the remaining portion is, the remaining part is a non-finite clause to be. So do you think a finite, non-finite can assign case to the subject? Hello?
No, ma'am.
So the reference is within the local domain here because to be tired is Ram. Ram is the one who is tired. So we can see that it is bound within the local domain, but that means it takes its reference from the main clause. Isn't it so?
Yes.
So again, we can see that this NP trace is unlike the other empty category, small PRO. The reference is not outside the domain, rather the reference is within the domain. Since it is a non-finite clause, of course, the subject is the part of the main clause, which is applicable to the subordinate clause also. So it has got the reference within the local domain. Okay, clear? So it follows principle A of binding theory, just like a reflexive or a reciprocal. The reference is within the local domain. Okay? Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now if you look at this table, you will understand which all are what and see, all the other noun phrases and lexical phrases, like if you are using a noun phrase like Ram, it is free everywhere. So that is principle C. According to principle C, a lexical noun phrase must be free everywhere. A referential expression must be free everywhere. That means all the other lexical phrases or noun phrases must be free everywhere. So if you are using a noun or be it a proper noun or common noun, the reference is free. The reference is free.
That means you don't need to follow any principles. It is very, it is free. So let us take the, let us just look at the table. PRO, capital PRO, can be anaphoric. Sometimes it takes its reference from the local domain. Sometimes the reference is outside the local domain. So capital PRO can be anaphoric and can also be pronominal. Sometimes it will have a governor. Sometimes the reference will be outside the local domain. So it can be capital P. Capital PRO is both anaphoric, can be sometimes anaphoric and sometimes pronominal. But small pronominals and PRO, small PRO are always pronominal. They can't be anaphoric. They will not take its reference from the local domain. PROs, pronouns and small PRO. Then let us take anaphors and noun phrase phrases. They are all anaphoric. As we have seen just now, noun phrase phrases and anaphors follow principle A. That means they are all anaphoric. They take its reference from the local domain itself. And what about the last one? Lexical noun phrases and W traces. They are free everywhere. Lexical noun phrases, if you are using a proper noun or common noun, the reference is free. That is what the principle C says. A referential expression must be free everywhere. I hope binding theory is clear to you now. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, moving on. Now we are going to deal with a very important part of syntax, that is the syntax of scope. See, if you look at some sentences, you find that it gives rise to multiple interpretation. Why is it possible? This is what we are going to discuss in syntax of scope. Scope deals with the possibility of interpretation. For example, if you have a sentence like, everyone in this room knows two languages. Everyone in the room knows two languages. In what old ways you can interpret the sentence? Everyone in the room knows two languages. Has it got only one meaning? Everyone in the room knows two languages. Please tell me, has it got only one meaning? Everyone in this room knows two languages.
Yes, ma'am.
Is it because the languages can be different, ma'am?
Languages can be different. That is one interpretation. Or there are only two languages. Say, for example, Malayalam and English. Everyone in this room knows Malayalam and English. Another way we can say that everyone in this room knows some of the other two languages. Languages. So these are the two interpretations. Yeah. So you will see that this everyone, that indefinite pronoun, everyone, in one interpretation, the scope goes to everyone. In the other interpretation, you can see that two languages has got a wider scope. Isn't it so? When you give scope to the word everyone, you'll get the interpretation that everyone in this room knows any of the two languages. But if you are giving scope to two languages, again you will see that okay, two languages mean can be any two languages. Okay, clear? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
So again, it is again the notion of logical form is part of generative grammar. Again, he came up with this in his book Syntactic Structures, where he said that the structure of a sentence is derived from, as you know, the deep structure. Then it undergoes two levels of interpretation. First is in its pronounced version, that's phonological level, and the other one is its logical level. That is, PF is the pronounced version and LF is the logical level, logical form. Okay, so from the deep structure we can derive two interpretation. One is phonological level, and again the two versions are, one is phonological level and the other is logical level. Again, this scope comes along with the logical level, because in the logical level you can interpret the sentence in more than one way. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now we are moving on to the scope bearing elements in English. Not every element can bear scope. So these are the elements which carry scope in a sentence. First one is adverb. Second one is quantifiers. third one is focusing words such as only and even. Then fourth one is negative words such as no and not. See, this part is very important because this question often comes from this last unit, negation, the scope of negation, the scope of adverbs. So such type of questions are always asked for an exam. So when you study this, keep that in mind. This is a very important part of syntax. Adverbs. So first we will deal with adverbs. The traditional definition of adverb is something that modifies a verb. Hello? So traditional definition of adverb says that an adverb can modify a verb, an adjective, another adverb. You can see, look at the examples. The first one, Harish runs fast. The adverb fast modifies the verb run. The second sentence, I meet him almost daily. Some disturbance are coming. So that person, please mute your mic. Can others please mute your mic? So I meet him almost daily. In the second sentence, you can see that daily is the adverb. When do you meet him? Daily. How often? Almost. So you can see that the word almost qualifies the adverb daily. So almost is also counted as an adverb. Then look at the third one. You are really nice. What does that word really do in that sentence? You are really nice.
Modifying an adjective.
Very good. It modifies an adjective. So nice is an adjective which is modified by the adverb really. Anyway, that is a traditional definition, but almost really, they are intensifiers and quantifiers. So we don't always count them as adverbs. So we better go for another definition. Can be defined as a word that modifies a verb or a verb phrase or a sentence. That is the modern definition of an adverb. Can be defined as a word that modifies a verb. It can be a verb, a phrase, it can even be a sentence. Even a sentence can act like an adverb, as we saw in the earlier examples. Look at the classification of adverbs. These are the traditional classification: adverb of time, adverb of place, adverb of manner. We will look at the first word. I shall meet you soon at the main crossing. He finally came an hour later. Ram leaves for work at 8 a.m. The underlined words, in the first sentence, underlined word is just a word. It's an adverb. If you look at the second sentence, you can see that it's a phrase. An hour later, it's a phrase. If you look at the third sentence, the underlined part is a prepositional phrase because it begins with a preposition at. See you tomorrow. Tomorrow is a noun which acts like an adverb. I'll meet him next Friday. It's a noun phrase. Isn't it so? So in the last sentence, you see that now next Friday is a noun phrase which functions like an adverb. When will you meet him? I'll meet him next Friday. Friday, tomorrow, they are all nouns, but they can function like adverbs. So in these sentences, these underlined parts, underlined words or group of words function like adverbs. See, they are not always an adverb, but sometimes can be an adverbial phrase or prepositional phrase. Can even a noun can function like an adverb. Then we have the second classification of adverb as adverb of place. Then come here. Here, again, it's an adverb. I shall meet you. Choose immediate vicinity. I shall meet you soon at the main crossing. Again, even though it's a place, it shows you the location. Where will you meet me? At the main crossing. It shows location. It's a prepositional phrase that shows location. He put the box down 10 yards away. Again, you can see the adverb down 10 yards away. Shows distance from the location, shows distance. So they're all, even though they're all adverbs of place, their function is different. Okay, then the last one is adverb of manner. Again, that you know, he runs fast, he speaks slowly, the performers dance very beautifully. Fast, slowly, beautifully, they are all adverbs. It shows the manner of the verb. If you're asking the question how, you will get the answer adverb of manner. If you ask the question when, you will get adverb of time. If you ask the question where, you will get adverb of place. Okay? You have other adverbs also, like adverb of reason and so on. I have only included the most important type of adverbs. Now, another classification of adverbs is given by a critic, literary linguist, Macaulay. These are the classification that he put forward. One is verb of modifying adverbs. Look at the first sentence. He spoke fluently. The adverb fluently modifies only the verb speak. He spoke fluently. But verb bar modifying or verb of phrase modifying adverbs are adverbs that modifies a phrase, not just a word. Rather, it's a adverb which modifies a phrase as a whole. The boss reluctantly granted me medical leave. The adverb reluctantly not just qualifies the verb granted, but it qualifies the whole verb or phrase, granted me medical leave. If you take the verb granted only, you won't find the sentences complete. The boss, how did he grant you, reluctantly granted me what, medical leave? That has also to be added in order to get a complete sense. So you can say that reluctantly is not simply a verb of modifying adverb, it's a verb of phrase modifying adverb. So we can also have sentence modifying adverbs, like fortunately Ram has enough savings to meet the expense. Fortunately, the word fortunately not only qualifies the verb, it also qualifies a noun phrase. Fortunately, Ram has enough savings to meet the expenses. That adverb qualifies the whole sentence. So we call them sentence modifying adverbs. Okay. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we are going to see the scope of adverbs. See, I have given a sentence. This sentence I have taken from your textbook only. This teacher always has 5 students in his class on Mondays. See, you have 2 words underlined. One is always and the noun phrase 5 students. So can you give me the interpretation of this sentence? The teacher always has 5 students in his class on Mondays. If you are giving scope to the adverb always, what is the interpretation? Hello.
In all classes, ma'am. Always means in all classes, ma'am.
Most of the time.
The teacher always have 5 students. The students will be different. Sometimes the 5 students will be different. But anyway, the teacher always has 5 students.
Adverbial clause of time.
No, I am not asking you which adverb it is. Rather, I ask you what is the scope of the adverb there. Always. If you are giving emphasis to the adverb always, you will see that the teacher, no matter who those 5 students are, anyway, the teacher always has 5 students in his class. The students will be different, but anyway, he always has 5 students. That is one interpretation. So if you give scope to the adverb, you will get one interpretation. So if you are giving scope to the 5 students, noun phrase 5 students, again, you will get another interpretation. The teacher always has this particular 5 students in his class on Mondays. These 5 students are same. They always come in his class. Isn't it so?
Yes.
So yes. He has a group of 5 students,
yes, miss,
who may love his class. So they're always present in his class. That is another way of interpreting the sentence. Now, it is always the case that the teacher has exactly 5 students, no more or less, in his class on Mondays. So in that sentence, you are giving importance to the adverb always. So in the second sentence, the interpretation is there are 5 students. These are the 5 students, A, B, C, D, and E. They are always present in his class. These 5 students, they are always present in his class. That is, this interpretation you get when you give importance to the noun phrase, 5 students. Okay, so in the first sentence, the adverb always has wider scope. In the second interpretation, you can see the noun phrase has wider scope. Now, the scope of quantifiers. This is how you use adverbs in sentence. So, adverbs can bring about scope in a sentence. Next is the scope of quantifiers. Quantifiers are expressions that indicate quantities. They are numerals. They can be numerals like 2, 3. They are quantifiers. They can be called the quantifiers. We can also label all, some, many, any, such adjectives as quantifiers. Again, indefinite pronouns like someone, something, everybody, nobody, anything, they can also be called the quantifiers. So these group of things come under the term quantifiers. They can be numerals, they can be quantitative adjectives, they can also be indefinite pronouns. Now the scope of quantifiers. Look at the sentence, someone loves everyone.
both use indefinite pronouns. Someone loves everyone. If you are giving importance to the first indefinite pronoun, someone, you get one interpretation. And if you give importance to the second indefinite pronoun, everyone, you get another interpretation. So can anyone tell me which all are the possible interpretation? So when you give importance to someone, what is the interpretation? Someone loves everyone. Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Give importance to whoever that someone is.
That is when you give importance to everyone.
Okay.
See, if you are giving importance to someone, there is this someone who loves everyone.
So that particular individual.
That individual loves everyone. So in the second case, you are saying that there would be someone who loves everyone. So I can even hope that there will be someone who loves me. That is the second interpretation. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
So when you give importance to someone, you get one interpretation. So you can see that someone has wider scope in that sentence. In the second interpretation, you see that everyone has wider scope. That means for every person, there'll be someone to love you. That is the second interpretation. Now we are going to see the special quantifiers only and even. They're important because, again, they can highlight a verbal phrase in a sentence. Look at the sentences. Only Ram knows how to sing. I only wanted to help you. Man does not live only by bread. See, that words in italics are highlighted by the word only and even. Only Ram knows how to sing. In that particular sentence, you can see that only highlights whom?
Ram.
So it acts like an adjective, right? Isn't it so? But in the second sentence, I only wanted to help you. What is the function of only there?
An adverb.
It's like an adverb, right? Because it qualifies the verb help. Again, third one, man does not live only by bread. It qualifies the noun bread. So we can see that it acts like an adjective. So only and even can act like an adjective as well as an adverb. So they are called focus linked elements. They are used to focus or highlight a particular word or phrase. It can function like an adjective, it can function like an adverb as well. Even a child can lift this box. That sentence even qualifies the child, so it's an adjective. I don't even want to talk to her. So even want to talk to her. Again, you see that even the focus linked element even is used to highlight the verb talk, so it's an adverb. He couldn't have imagined it even in his dreams. Dreams is a noun, so even it's used as an adjective. Now, when used as quantifiers, they exhibit scope, especially in relation to negation. So when they come along with negative words, they get wider scope. Look at the sentence. You can not only read these books. Second sentence, you cannot only read these books. See, in the first sentence, you are giving importance to the negative word not. Then what does it mean? The scope is wider for the negative word not. Then the interpretation is you can borrow them as well. You can take them home as well. You can not only read these books, but you can take them home also. That is one interpretation. That is when you give importance to the negative word no. Then look at the second sentence. You cannot only read these books, but you have to do something else. You can't simply read these books, but you should also tell me what it is. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
So only has wider scope. That means the quantifier only gets wider scope in the second interpretation. Similarly, look at the last two sentences. Mary has not even begun the lecture. If you give importance to not, the interpretation is she hasn't even begun the lecture. So let alone answering questions, she hasn't even begun the lecture. So in that interpretation, we are giving importance to the negative word not. But look at the second sentence. Mary has even not begun the lecture yet. She's waiting for someone to start. She has even not begun. She has even not. Even. There you are giving importance to the quantifier even. She has even not begun the lecture yet. That means she is waiting for something. She is waiting for someone. Okay,
So the interpretation has changed. Thereby, you have seen that the quantifier even gets wider scope, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it clear? Now we are moving on to the last part of the unit, that is negation. As you know what is negation. You are using negative words like not, no, then contraction, no, empty. And also you can use negative indefinite pronouns, nothing, nobody. They can all be used to bring about the effect of negation. Can be adjective, can be adverbs, can be even conjunctions like neither nor. Again, you can take negation as a logical operator, as something which can operate on its logical form. That affects the truth value. Again, negation, like other operators, adverb or quantifiers, they are also score-bearing elements. Let's see an example. If you consider snow is white as a true sentence, then you will have to admit that snow is not white as a false sentence. It affects the truth value, right?
Yes.
Again, if you are accepting the moon is made of green cheese as being false, then see, look at the sentence. The moon is not made of green cheese as being true. Look at the difference that the word not brings about. So if you consider a positive sentence to be true, the negative would be false. That is how it is. But sometimes these kind of sentences create a paradox. This is called a Russell's paradox. Bertrand Russell is a famous British mathematician and writer who won a Nobel Prize. So look at the sentence. This explains the paradox. This sentence is not true. What is special about this sentence? It's a negative sentence, right? If you are accepting this sentence to be true, actually, is it not true? Is it true? If you're accepting the sentence as true, that you are saying that the sentence is not true. Am I right? Didn't you get what I said?
Ma'am, can you please repeat that?
If you are accepting the sentence as not true, you would think that if the sentence is true, then why should I accept this sentence as not true? Because the sentence is true. Because it's grammatically correct. The sentence is not true. If I am accepting that the sentence is true, I'm myself making a paradox, because I'm accepting the sentence as true, even though the sentence itself says that this is not true. Is it clear?
Yes, I've
got it.
Did you get that? So this kind of sentences are called a paradox. This is called a Russell's paradox. The sentence is not true. So you are simply confused. If you are not accepting this sentence as not true, then again, there is a question. Is the sentence is true? Because the sentence is grammatically correct, there is nothing problematic with the sentence. At the same time, if you are not accepting the sentence, again, you are making a mistake. Even if you are accepting the sentence, you are kind of creating a confusion. So this is called a Russell's paradox. Now we are going to see the two types of negation. You can bring about a morphological negation by using some prefixes like un, in, unlucky, in this, then to express the opposites. But if you are using negative words like no or not, you are also negating the meaning. But which is stronger? She is very unhappy with the situation. She expressed her displeasure. Which is stronger? I'm not happy with the situation, or I am quite unhappy with the situation. Which is stronger? Which one is stronger, morphological negation or syntactic negation? Which one is stronger? I'm not happy with the situation. I am unhappy with the situation. Which is stronger? Which is a stronger statement?
Unhappy, ma'am.
Exactly. So morphological negation is stronger, while syntactic negation is milder, and it is syntactic negation that carries the scope. Note, you can't think about any scope in morphological negation, while syntactic negation can create some scope. Let us see some examples. Look at the sentence. Many arrows didn't hit the target. Note, many arrows hit the target. Both are negative sentences. And in what all are the possible interpretation of the sentence? There are two test sentences. Many arrows didn't hit the target. Not many arrows hit the target. Both are sentences using negation. So if you take the first sentence, you can see that it has got two meanings. Many arrows didn't hit the target. Many students didn't pass the exam. That means I also didn't pass the exam. I passed the exam. Both can be the interpretation, right? If I'm telling my fair father that I didn't, many students didn't pass their exam. That means there is a chance that I passed the exam, and there is also a chance that I didn't pass the exam. So there are two interpretations. What about the second one? Not many students passed the exam. What did you mean by that? Not many students passed the exam, but I passed the exam. So it gives rise to only one interpretation. But the first sentence can be interpreted in two ways. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
So this is why it is called scope. Because if you are giving the importance to many, you will get one meaning. And if you are giving importance to not, you will get another meaning. But here, it is the use of many and not brings about the scope. But if you are giving importance to the word not, only not, you will get one interpretation. But if you are giving important emphasis to not and many, you can have different interpretation, as in the first example. But in the second example, many is there, but still it doesn't have the scope, just because that is arranged in a different way. The arrangement of sentence is different. The arrangement of words is different, but the first sentence has got a wider scope. Okay, clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So the first interpretation says that many has wider scope, and the second interpretation says that node has wider scope. The both can be applicable only in the first sentence, but in the second sentence, you can have only one interpretation. That is, it was for many arrows A, it was not the case that A hit, not many arrows hit the target means, not many students pass the exam means I have passed the exam. That is the only possible interpretation from the second sentence. Now we are moving on to negative polarity items. There are positive polarity items and there are negative polarity items. Negative polarity items are items which comes along with negative sentences. They can be used only in a negative context. Look at the sentences. Sita knows something. Sita doesn't know anything. Can you use anything with a positive sentence? Sita knows anything. Can you use that?
No.
No. That means anything is a negative polarity item. Similarly, I like spinach very much. I don't like spinach at all. Can you use at all with a positive sentence? I like spinach at all.
No.
No, again, at all is a negative polarity item. Mr. X drinks a lot. Mr. X doesn't drink much. So much is again, you can't use much along with a positive sentence since it's a negative polarity item. That's all about negative polarity items. Here ends our unit. I hope things are clear to you. Is it all okay? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Shall we move on to the last block, that is stylistics?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So if you have any doubt, you can personally text me. I can clarify.
Plain negation. Okay. Hello?
Okay, ask me.
Yeah, we have to include all those negation as a logical the scope of negation.
Yes, of course.
Everything we have to include in that answer, right? Am I right?
There is not much to include. There isn't much to include. Did you find it very difficult or did you find it so elaborate?
Yeah.
There are only two types of negatives, like morphological and syntactic. There are two types of negation, morphological negation and syntactic negation, and it is syntactic negation that brings about scope, and these are the scope of negation. You can explain it with some examples, and you should also write the negative polarity items. That is all what you are supposed to include under the question negation. There is not much about it.
Okay, ma'am, got it. Thank you.
Okay, so now we are moving on to the last and final block, that is stylistics. In between there are some blocks, but I've told you that you can read it. They're easy compared to others. They're much easier. Okay, so we are moving on to stylistics. Stylistics, before moving on to the term stylistic, we should know something called a synchronic
and diachronic variations. I hope you remember what is synchronic and what is diachronic that we have dealt when we saw the first block. You remember what is synchronic and what is diachronic?
Synchronic, change in a particular time.
Changes at a given time. So if you, that's why I have given the example of writings of modern authors. If you are reading the modern authors, you will see that each of them have dealt with the subject in a different way, depending on their culture, depending on their customs, class, and so on. So if you are focusing on those changes at a given time, we call it synchronic. And if you are trying to compare the difference of literature between the Elizabethan age and the Romantic age, you are actually doing diachronic study, that is diachronic.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the changes of language as it is evolved over time, that is diachronic. Synchronic means the variations at a given time. So we are going to focus on the synchronic variation. And there are of three kinds. I've told you that synchronic is important. When we discussed Escher, we saw that these are the two divisions, synchronic and diachronic, and we are supposed to focus more on synchronic study in order to study a language. So synchronic variations can be of three kinds, variations in dialect, style, and register. Dialect is a regional, so social variation of a language. Again, a dominant dialect often becomes the standard dialect, as in the case of East Midland dialect. You have studied Chaucer, haven't you? There you have seen Canterbury Tales. He used East Midland dialect. That became later the standard dialect. Similarly, a dominant dialect of a region becomes the standard dialect of that place. In Kerala also, we have a standard dialect. That is a dialect of the, maybe dialect of the central part of Kerala. That is called the dominant dialect, which becomes the standard, which is the standard dialect. Again, there are some pronunciation differences between the dialects of different places, like British RP. Look at the differences. There can be, the difference can be in the form of, difference can be in pronunciation, meaning, or also in the structure. Look at the differences. In pronunciation, we have last, dance, castle for English becomes last, dance, castle for American. Americans. Similarly, there are syntactic differences also. I'll meet him. Similarly, they say, I didn't meet him. Instead, the British people would say, I've met him. I didn't meet him. I haven't met him. I didn't get it. I haven't got it. That is how the British says. British uses this perfect form more than simple past, while Americans are fond of using simple past. Okay, that's a syntactic difference. Then there are the lexical differences also. Petrol, gas. Petrol is for British and gas, the same. Petrol is the petrol is gas for American. Similarly, luggage is baggage for American. Then there are spelling differences also. Color is color. C-O-L-O-U-R is British, while C-O-L-O-R is American. They all come under morphological difference. Dive, dow. Dive is the past participle form of dive. But for American, it is dove. Okay? The V3 form for British dive is dived. But it's in American, it is dove. Similar advertisement is advertisement. Laboratory is laboratory. These are the differences. These are the basic differences. These are the dialectical differences. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Moving on, idiolect. Idiolect is the individual variation of the language. How an individual uses a language. That is different from another person. So this is called idiolect is the individual variation of the language. Then isogloss is an imaginary line which divides two areas. Maybe it is an imaginary line between two regions which uses different dialects. There is not a physical line, rather the line would be imaginary. So if we have a district next to us, both of us would be using different dialects. There is not a line, there is not a concrete line. Rather, we think that from this place onwards, these people use a different dialect. This is called an isogloss. Then, when this isogloss is bundled, we call it a dialect boundary. If there is a bundling of many isoglosses, we call it a dialect boundary. now dialects and language. So there are descriptive and functional uses to distinguish the terms. Structurally, we call them, there's concept of structurally means that the changes can be described or it can be based on the function of the language there. So there can be that can be described in structural terms like the grammar, like meaning, their pronunciation, and also it's based on the functional level. So again, we have this concept of mutual intelligibility, which explains how these two languages, how two dialects can be counted as the dialect of the same language. So if a person who uses a different dialect understands the dialect of another person, then we can say that both of the dialects come from the same language. Okay, so this concept can be explained using the concept of mutual intelligibility. If I can understand the Malayalam by a person of a region, another region, that means both of them are dialects of Malayalam. Clear? And this concept is called mutual intelligibility. For example, Bhojpuri and Awadhi, they are both dialects of Hindi. Because a person who speaks Bhojpuri can understand Awadhi. That means both are dialects of the same language, that is Hindi. Then sometimes even two dialects won't be mutually intelligible to two persons. Even though both of them come from the same language, that won't be intelligible to another person. My dialect won't be intelligible to another person. Okay, for example, in Chinese, there are two dialects, Pekingese and Cantonese. These are not intelligible to, or a person who speaks Pekingese, I don't know how to be pronounced, how that word is, Pekingese. Pekingese won't be understood by a person who speaks Cantonese. Okay, again, sometimes a dialect will be raised to the status of a language through linguistic consideration. Most often, the political and social strength of a dialect determines whether it can be accepted as a language or not. If it is a politically strong, or if it has got power, if a language is powerful, if a dialect is powerful, it can be raised to the position of a language. Okay, a very influential dialect can sometimes become a language. Now we'll see the concept of accent. We have discussed these things while we discussed the phonology. Again, accent is the peculiarities of pronunciation used by the speaker or to phonological variations in dialect. There are different types of accent, British accent, RP. RP is a received pronunciation, that is the standard English accent. Standard British accent is called RP, and standard Indian accent is called the GIE, General Indian English. Similarly, American accent, GAE, that is English, which is followed by the public schools in America or CNN, like that. Then the word, for example, the word gate, it is gate in received pronunciation, while it is gate in GIE. So gate is acceptable because that is the standard Indian accent. Similarly, home, it is not home, it is home. Okay, it is written wrongly there, it is home. The inverted E plus U, O. It is home, while GIE, it is home, long O sound. Again, we can't say that it is wrong, since it is GIE, General Indian accent. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now style. Again, now we have come to the most important part of stylistics. It is style. Style refers to the variation of language due to a situation, due to a particular situation or a context. When you are in a particular context, you would be using a language which is different from your normal language. If you're in an office, you would be using a language which is different from the way you use language at your home. That is called the style. So you are using a language depending on the situation. That is a style. So there are different styles like casual, consultative, formal, frozen. The more informal the style is, the less possibility there is variation. If you are more formal with the style, you'll be following the code. There won't be much variation because those people who are using formal style will be using the same language, almost same language. Isn't it so? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
See, if you are using a formal style, of course, you'll be following a style which is common among all those who use a formal style. There won't be much variations. But if you have a style of your own at your home, that would be different from other other styles. But a formal style will be almost same. That's why they said that the more formal the style is, the less possibility there is of variation. So we have seen the different types of style. An example is given here. Frozen style means a very it's too formal. Visitors should use the two X's at the rear on their way out. It is a very severe formal style, we can say. Formal means visitors should leave by the X's at the rear. Consultative style, would you mind leaving by the X's at the rear? Casual, you could leave by the doors at the back. Intimate, very intimate style is out, you go by the back door. You can see the difference in the language also. The style has also changed as with the change of style, as with the change of situation. Okay, now moving on to register. Register is the language that is determined by the variation of the language determined by the subject matter. If you are using a doctor, you'd be using a language which is quite like unlike that of the common man. You'd be using some terms which are familiar only to doctors. That is a register. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
If it is a scientific writing, you would be using some words which are often in passive voice, some in the form of formally, technical terminology, etc. We have an example here, neuraminic acid. Most of the words seem Greek to us just because we are not familiar with those words. We are not familiar with those technical words. So they are all registers which are understood only by those people who are in that, who belong to that field. Literary register, this is about a register. But in the case of literary register, that is determined by the precision and elegance. So a literary register means it has to reflect language more clear and accurate. The reflection should be more clear and accurate in case of literary register. So it depends on precision and elegance. Moving on, linguistics and literature relationship. Linguistics, as you know, studies the structure of language, while literature makes use of the aspect of these linguistic features. Okay, so linguistics studies the system or structure of language, while literature use those structure to express what I want to say, what the writer wants to say, what the critic wants to say. So again, linguistics could be taken as parallel to Lang or Coe. If you are taking linguistics as Lang or Coe, we can call literature as a parole, the way of expression. I hope you remember Lang and parole. Lang is the underlying structure, while parole is the realm of freedom. It is the way you express language. So literature is connected to parole, while linguistics is connected to Lang. Okay. Hello.
Okay, ma'am.
Then again, it is not only linguistic system. We use language to communicate. So there is the social purpose also. While literature recreates, and even though it recreates and reflects life, it ultimately comes from the imagination of the writer. Even though he is trying to project the real life situation, then also we can say that it is not 100% real. That comes from his imagination. So there are colors of his imagination in a writing. So you can't see that literature is complete reality. Again, the conventions of speech interaction is applicable to literature, but it can free itself from the shackles by a variety of. You have to follow the rules of language. At the same time, there are many instances whereby the writers break these conventions. For example, in poetry, usually there is a pattern for stress. That means this function class words are not to be stressed, while form class words are to be stressed. But when you look at those, when you look at poems, you can see that in order to agree with the meter, he would be compromising on the stress pattern. That is very common. Okay, so we can see that again, spelling, the spelling variation, the grammatical variations are all there in literature. That means the writer is free to break the conventions. But in language, you have to follow it as such. So look at the last definition. By popular definition, literature is the creative use of language, and thus in the context of general linguistic description can be created with the use of unorthodox or deviant forms of language. So in literature, you will come across unorthodox or deviant forms of language.
That means it is a creative use of language. We are not simply using the language, but rather we are using the language in a creative way. That is what you see in literature. That is connection between linguistics and literature. I hope the idea is clear to you. Now moving on, the connection between linguistics and literary criticism. That idea can be understood from the quote. The critic's first and most important task must be to discover, as far as he is able, the objective characteristics of the work under consideration. So first of all, you should be the most important task of the critic is to open up the objective characteristics of the work. That means the structural attributes of the work should be analyzed by the critic. So again, that was the emotive response to a work of art was denied by T.S. Eliot. He completely objected against the idea of an emotive response to the towards a text by a critic. Because earlier, we used to analyze a work of art or a book, literary work, based on some prejudice and bias. So often we'll have an emotive response to a work of art. But later, with the modern new critics and with the ideas of T.S. Eliot, it is said that, or even the Prague School of Linguistics, they all supported the idea that a critic's main task is to understand or analyze the structure of a book. It is not, it should not be a subjective analysis, rather it should be an objective analysis. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
So linguistics became prominent. Earlier, the responses were often emotive. They were emotional responses. If I don't like a person, as in the times of neoclassicism, they used their writings to criticize others. C-R-I-T-I-Q-U-E, critique others. Or to criticize others. Or to make fun of others. That is what they thought to be the function of literature. But T.S. Eliot and new critics, they were against the idea of this subjective analysis. They rather stressed the importance of objective analysis, or rather analyzing the structure of a work of art. Again, the concepts of the new critics like practical criticism, then ambiguity, then Brooks' paradox, gesture and irony, all those were attempts towards this idea of objectivity in literary criticism. Now, moving on, stylistics. Again, we have seen what is style. What is stylistics? It refers to the way in which language is used, how we use language in a given context by a given person for a given purpose. Because when you are given a piece of...
Ma'am, yes. It's not clear.
It's not clear?
No, ma'am.
Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Now it's okay.
So you didn't hear what I said earlier? Stylistics again refers to the way in which language is used as in a given situation by a given person for a given purpose. That is what the critics do. That is what the critics are supposed to do. Again, style can be studied both in the spoken and written varieties of language, whether it be literary or non-literary. In literary writing, we can say that the term stylistics applies to linguistic habits of a writer or the way language is used in a particular genre or period or school of writing. We say the style of Wordsworth, the style of Keats. We can also say the style of romantic poets. That is how we say it. So we can say that we use the term to refer to the habits of the writer or to the way language is used in a particular genre. For example, poetry. So we have different style, like epistolary style, euphemistic style, elegiac style, and so on. Again, the aim of literary stylistics is to lead the critic's concern about aesthetic appreciation with the linguistic concern regarding linguistic description. He has to do both aesthetic appreciation along with linguistic description. He can't constrain himself with aesthetic appreciation, but also he has to tell us about the linguistic description. He has to also give a description of the linguistic features or the structure of the book. Clear?
Okay, ma'am.
Now, we just said that a critic's duty is to come up with an aesthetic and linguistic appreciation of this text. That means he has to analyze both the style and content. Okay, so style, what is the connection of style to the content? It is, style can be defined as a way of writing or a mode of expression, while content is the matter, and style is the way of expressing that content. There are three approaches, monism, dualism, and pluralism. Okay, so monism says that there is no difference between the style and content. That means both are, they are inseparable. Again, according to monist view, it began with Aristotle and Plato, it was there from olden times onwards. There is no distinction in a language between form and meaning. You can't distinguish meaning from its form or from its style. Then Flaubert said that it is like body and soul, form and content to me are one. There is no difference at all. So he also said about the inseparability of style from the content. Look at the sentence, come stealing night, scarf of the tender eye of pitiful day. What are the figures of speech used by the writer for Shakespeare? You have studied poetry, haven't you? These are lines taken from Macbeth, Act 3, Scene 2, 46 line. Come stealing night, scarf of the tender eye of pitiful day. Which all are the figures of speech used in these lines? Very good. Personification. It is personification. That means Macbeth here is speaking to both the night and the day, as if they were capable of sight and action, right? Come stealing night, scarf of the tender eye of beautiful day. Do you know the occasion here? He's floating to murder Banquo. So he calls on the nighttime to come quickly so that he can cover up his murder. Because he is calling night. Night stands for evil or darkness. So he is choosing night. He has chosen night. That is evil time. And he is, at the same time, he is ashamed of it. Because in him, he has this natural compunction, that is pity or love or virtue. So he doesn't want this evil part of him to see the... He doesn't want this, good part of him to see the evil that he's going to do. That's why he says that, come stealing night. So he wants this night to cover up the evil that he is going to do. Clear? Can you separate the style of this poem from the content? Can you paraphrase the meaning from these lines? Can you simply paraphrase the meaning of these lines? Again, night and day are personified. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you paraphrase the lines? Can you simply paraphrase the lines? Is it possible to paraphrase the lines without the use of these metaphors? Even when you try to give a paraphrase of it, it won't be complete without using the appropriate metaphors as Shakespeare has used. Okay, because he's expressing his mind. So we can see that these metaphors or the personification, the figure of speech denies a literal sense. So we are forced to make sense out of these lines. Even though these night and days are not persons as we know, we still take them as persons. So we are forced to find an interpretation beyond the truth functional meaning, right? So we can say that here the style is inseparable from the content. It's not possible to paraphrase those lines without the help of those metaphors. The metaphors serve to express the idea of the writer, or the metaphors serve to express the mind of the speaker. Here in this context, it is Macbeth. Clear? Because he hasn't simply used his style, rather, he has used the proper words to express what is in his mind. So those paraphrasing without those metaphors won't be is sufficient to express the idea. So he has used apt metaphors. So we can say that both are inseparable. Both style and content are inseparable based on the lines. And there is another idea, that is dualism, which restricts style to those choices, either manner or matter, or expression rather than content. Okay, either it's a choice of manner rather than matter, or it is a choice of expression rather than content. Let's take the two type of dualistic arguments. One is style as a dress of thought and style as a manner of expression. What is style as a dress of thought? I have taken a quote from Pope, an essay on literary criticism. True it is nature to advantage dress what oft was thought but never so well expressed. What do you mean by this? When do I think a lot, I'm not able to express it fully. That means thought is more important. Even though I think a lot, I am not able to express it the way I think it is. Right? That means there is a difference between style and matter, the content and the manner in which we express the content. So this this particular idea was very popular during neoclassical and Renaissance time, because they considered language as a dress. The language was considered as like a house that can hide the content. A dress which can, just like how the dress cover up the body. Okay. Hello. So you can hide your thought by using some words, or you can bring about the difference or change of ideas by using words, phrases, and sentences. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So if you use language, the matter can be interpreted in different ways. So style was considered as a dress of thought. You're dressing your thought with the style. So that is why neoclassicists were so fond of mock epics, because whenever they want to ridicule their opponent, they used mock epics. They used to write mock heroic poems so that they thought they can ridicule others. They can make fun of others. They can satirize others. Next is style as a manner of expression. Again, here also the substance or content of the thought is same, but this manner of saying it, again, the manner of saying, be it words, phrases, and language, the way we choose it would be different. That vary the total meaning. So just the choice in this way of putting things, the style resides. Again, look at the sentence. The speech was made by the senator after dinner. You have two sentences. The senator made a postprandial oration. Both mean the same. The speech was made, the content is same. But look at the change. So the way you use language can bring about some slight changes. The speech was made by the senator after dinner. It gives you sense. But look at the second sentence. The senator made a postprandial oration. It gets a significance here, right? It is more significant than the previous one. It's just related to our sense, or it's just related to you. What is the content? The speech was made by the senator. It's a passive voice sentence, and it is very plain. The meaning is very plain and it makes sense. What about the second one? If you want to give a sentence significance, you have to use the words accordingly. That is what style as a manner of expression says. You can say the same things in different way. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
If you are adding stylistic value to sense, that gives to significance. So when you're attributing some more qualities to your words, or if you are trying to use more standard words in your language, it becomes more significant. That's why we call some orators, some people orators, because their quality the way they use words would be quite different from the way we use it. When you we say something, it appears to our sense, or it carries meaning. But at the same time, when we use the sentence in a different way by using more elaborate words or more flowery words, it would sound different. It would be more significant. It sound more significant for the listener. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now we are moving to the last one, pluralism. Again, plural. According to pluralist or pluralism, language performs a number of different functions. Earlier, we saw that style and content are same, and dualism said that you can use style to hide your thought. And the second was that you can express a language using different styles. And when coming to pluralism, you see that language performs a lot of functions, different functions, and any piece of language is likely to be the result of choices made on different functional levels. Let us look at the different functions of language. Can have a referential function, just like you read a newspaper. When you read a newspaper, the function of language is referential. When in advertising, the language will have a directive function, a persuasive function. It persuades us to do something. It persuades us to buy the product. Then there is emotive and social function. So thereby you can maintain your social and emotional bond, a casual conversation, a small talk. So all these show that language, choice of language are interrelated to one another within a network of functional choices. So you can choose language according to the function. Okay, that is what pluralism says. Now we are moving on to literal versus figurative meaning. Literal meaning is the core meaning, that is the central meaning. That is the non-figurative meaning, that is the surface level meaning. So the language that we use every day is to be taken literally. But figurative meaning is the inner meaning. So implied meaning, it's kind of implied meaning. You can, in literature, you can see that they use figures of speech like metaphor, simile, then personification, symbol, irony. Thereby, they bring about a different meaning. They give us an implied meaning. There is a meaning beyond the words. That is called the figurative meaning. Even a pronoun can bring about a change in the meaning. Okay, so the language of literature is basically intended to be taken figuratively. This has been done through foregrounding. This is done through foregrounding. Now we are going to see what is foregrounding. Again, this is a very important question, foregrounding. This question has come for the exam many times. Foregrounding. So foregrounding means to make some aspect of a discourse or representation the primary focus of attention. So when you read something, if you find that some part of the reading is more highlighted than the others, that means that words are foregrounded. So some pieces of information are given prominence in relation to other information. That is what you mean by foregrounding. So this was first used by Prague School of Linguistics to refer to stylistic feature characterizing poetic language using verbal devices. They have applied the verbal devices like irony and metaphor. The stylistic features were applied to poetic language, and thereby they tried to find out those words which are foregrounded in poetry. Then it can be achieved through deviation and parallelism. Now we will see what is deviation and parallelism. They are the two linguistic devices. So this foregrounding is achieved through deviation and parallelism. Did you understand the idea of foregrounding?
Yes, ma'am.
So one part would be highlighted more than the others. That is foregrounding. This is done through two linguistic devices. One is deviation and the other is parallelism. Now we will see, first we will say parallelism. Parallelism means there are constructions in which one of the structure will be given, one of the structure seems equivalent to another one. Then it uses phonological parallelism, that means through over regularity, rhyme, rhythm, meter, alliteration, assonance, they're all examples for over regularity. So that is not regular, that is not common in a normal language, rhyme, rhythm, meter, alliteration, assonance. So these devices are used to foreground poetry, as you see in poem.
then parallel constructions which occur in sequence and appear similar in structure may signal irony. Sometimes when they use similar construction, but rather than giving similarity, they would end up in giving an ironic sense. Okay. I'll give you an example for this later. Mainly two types. Grammatical parallelism is there, then phonological parallelism is there. Grammatical parallelism is grammatical parallelism is made through the structure, while phonological parallelism is made through sounds. Let us see grammatical parallelism first. Then parallelism. Grammatical parallelism, as I told you, it is done through, it is made through words, phrases, and flows. That is through the structure of sentence. Example, the poor young man hesitated and procrastinated. That is taken from Henry James' work, The Pupil. What is special with this sentence? The poor young man hesitated and procrastinated. Hesitated and procrastinated are verbs which are almost similar in meaning. Isn't it so? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Aren't they almost similar? Hesitated, procrastinated?
Yes, ma'am.
Then this is an example for parallel construction. But these two words are used to reinforce the meaning. Then he is hesitated and procrastinated. So by using a parallel construction, he emphasized the idea of his mindset. The young man hesitated and procrastinated. So this parallel construction reinforces the meaning and it gives emphasis. It gives emphasis in the context. Okay. Now look at the second one. This is an example for irony. As idle as a painted ship upon a painted ocean. Earlier we said that, see, when you use similar structures, rather than giving similarity, it gives irony. As idle as a painted ship upon a painted ocean. This line is taken from Coleridge's Ancient Mariner. What is special with this line? As idle as a painted ship upon a painted ocean. See, both the construction, both the noun phrases painted ship and painted oceans are parallel to each other in terms of structure because they use the same adjective painted. They almost seem identical, painted ship, painted ocean. Only thing is that the noun is different, but the adjectives, both adjectives are same. Then what is special with these two words? How does it bring about irony? The ship can be painted. Can the ocean be painted?
No.
So that brings about the unreality of the situation. Painted ocean is not a real situation. It's an unreal situation, right? But the painted ship is a real situation. So we can say that the words are ironic in the context of the poem. Because a real ship is compared to something which is painted, which is also unreal. So it is an imaginary situation. It is not a real situation upon a painted ocean. So the ocean cannot be painted. But so that is why it is said that it is ironic. The use of this parallel constructions. This painted ship and painted oceans are parallel construction because both of them use the same adjective painted. Is the idea clear?
Yeah, ma'am.
Then next one is the fair breeze. You might have heard of this line. The fair breeze blew, the white foam flew, the furrow followed free. Again, this line is taken from the Ancient Mariner. There are two clauses, right? The fair breeze blew, the white foam flew. Again, you can see that they are parallel to each other, almost same. The construction is almost same. They have the same construction. And the meaning also is complementary. The fair breeze blew, the white foam flew. So again, you can see that there is repetition of the structure. So that the structure is repeated so as to show a pleasantness of the scene. The scene is very pleasing and the mood is very lighthearted. So it creates a rhythm. Through that rhythm, it creates a very pleasant mood. The fair breeze blew, the white foam flew. So it's again an example for parallel construction. Okay. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Last one. I kissed thee before I killed thee. It's a very famous line from Othello.
Again, you can see that kissed and killed are similar in structure. Again, kind of it uses same syllables and all. There is only difference in one consonant sound. All the rest are same. Instead of S sound, he has used L sound. But anyway, even though the structure is almost similar, the meaning is completely different. But here we can say that Shakespeare has used both grammatical parallelism as well as phonological parallelism. Both in sound and grammar, it's a parallel construction. Because you can't compare kissing to killing. Kissing is an act of love. Killing is an act of vengeance or hatred. Again, you can see that Othello has a tortured mind. And at the same time, he loves Desdemona a lot. So this line is used to show his mindset. He's totally confused. So again, it's a parallel construction. Okay. Even though he loves her, he can't let her free, let her go free, because he loves her. And he has got only one solution, that is to kill her. So he is utterly helpless. That is a situation. Okay? Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, it's an example for parallel construction. Use of parallel construction means use of similar structures. Now we are going to see phonological parallelism. Again, you know what is phonology? That means sounds. You have parallelism at the level of sounds. Again, you have the same example, the fair breeze blew, the white foam flew. It's a very famous line, the fur of olive tree, the repetition of consonants, alliteration, burr sounds. So the alliteration. Alliteration is a kind of parallelism. Again, assonance is also a form of parallelism. You can see that oo sound, blue, flew. Again, it's identical. So that brings about rhyme. So it is again parallelism. So vowel sounds, this constant repetition of vowel sounds, consonant sound, they all create parallelism here. So the parallelism here is created through the use of similar sounds. Okay? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Moving on, deviation, the last one. We have two types of foregrounding. One is parallelism and second one was deviation. Now we'll see what is deviation. Deviation means foregrounding through the use of deviant construction. You don't have a normal construction. Rather, you would come across a construction which is deviant, which breaks the normal convention of language. They deviate from the rules of normal language, from the accepted norms of grammar, lexis, or morphology. Look at the first one. The what of a which of a wind. The what of a which of a wind. What do you mean by that? What and which? Do you use those relative pronouns in a normal sentence?
No.
But here, these relative pronouns are treated like they are nouns. Am I right? So, what and which, they are used to act like nouns in this sentence. So that he has used, that means E.E. Cummings has used it to give a tone of mysteriousness, to tone of mystery, a tone of intrigue. So we have a different meaning here. Okay? Again, it shows lightheartedness, the what of a witch of a wind. Second one is a grief ago. It's a poem by Dylan Thomas, A Grief Ago. Grief is given to act like a period of time. The word grief, it's a noun, which is treated like a period of time, like a month ago, like a week ago. But here, his grief, here Dylan Thomas has used grief because he measures time through the grief that he undergoes. That's why he has used the term a grief ago. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So he can't use month or year because he measures the time span through the grief that he underwent. That's why he uses the term a grief ago. Now look at the last one. The widow making unchilding, unfathering deeds. Look at the language, look at the deviation that Hopkins has used. It's a very famous poem, The Wreck of Deutschland. It is about the wreck of a ship called Deutschland, Wreck of the Deutschland. The widow making unchilding, unfathering deeds. Have you ever heard such expressions before? Widow making, unchilding. Fathering is a possible verb, but unfathering deeds. Again, you come across three adjectives which are not there in language. But here, he has used them for a particular purpose. Because here nature has made widows. They have killed, nature has killed fathers. It has killed husbands. It has killed children. That's why he has used the term the widow making, unchilding, unfathering deeds. Okay. So he has used these adjectives to emphasize the violence perpetrated by nature. Okay. By swallowing the steamer, by swallowing the ship. So nature has made widows. Nature has killed children. Nature has killed fathers. That's why Hopkins called nature as the widow making, unchilding, unfathering deeds, water. Okay, by swallowing the ship, nature has become widow making, unchilding, and unfathering. Is the idea clear?
Clear, ma'am.
This is called a deviation. We are using a deviant construction, means a construction which is not in normal use. Now, I don't know whether I'll get time. This is an example for how to analyze a passage. See, look at, are you able to read it?
Yes, ma'am.
So this is a passage, and just go through the passage we have found. Just go through the passage first. You may even go through first one or two lines, that would be enough. So you have many sentences which are given symbols like MC1, AC1, then NC1, AC1, NPPRC1. What do you mean by that? MC1 is main clause. There was once in the country of Alf Bay, a sad city, the saddest of cities, a city so ruinously sad, that is the main clause, that it had forgotten its name. Why is it given AC1? Ruminously sad, that it tells us about the result. It is so sad that it had forgotten its name. So some clause which talks about the result is called adverbial clause. So AC1 is adverbial clause. Then it stood by, again, it stood by a mournful sea full of glum fish. Again, it's noun phrase. Glum fish is noun phrase. Again, you can see that it stood by MC1, main clause. Which were so miserable to eat, which is relative pronoun. So we can say that which were so miserable to eat is a relative clause. That they made people, again relative clause. Belched with melancholy, it's a noun phrase or noun phrase clause. Then AC1, even though the skies were blue, again adverbial clause. In the month of the sad city stood, I mean, close one. This is how you divide a sentence. This is how you can divide a passage. First of all, you have to find out the main clauses and then subordinate clause. Subordinate clauses can be relative clause, adverbial clause, adjective clause, and so on. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we will see the use of the passage use dynamic words and also stative words. See, dynamic verbs takes about the action, while stative verbs talks about the state of mind, physical or mental state. So the author has used both dynamic words and stative words. Okay, so stative words give statement of fact, while dynamic verbs lead to figures of speech. So that is what stative verbs gives you fact, while dynamic words make the passage very active. Is it clear? so that we get a kind of realistic description. There is action, there is also the state. State means is, am, are, they're all state verbs. Because it tells us about the state of mind or state of physical or mental state. Both physical and mental state. See, had forgotten, stood, made, told, looked. They're all examples for state verbs. While belt, manufactured, packed, coat, hung, stuffed, they're all dynamic verbs. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
So an example is given here. So because we are given a kind of figurative speech by using this state, by using this dynamic words. Look at the description. They were prancing to battle instead of they were going to battle. Look, they were prancing to battle. So prancing is a state verb. It's a dynamic verb. By using a dynamic verb, or he can bring about, the author can bring about a very active situation, a mood of an active situation. They were prancing to battle. So that is why they said that dynamic verbs can lead to a figurative speech, like black smoke, cloud out of chimneys. Because they are given, they are treated like figures of speech. They are treated like a person. Then now figures of speech employed, changing the qualities of phenomena. You can see personification, as I have told you, sad city, then concretization of abstract qualities. And abstract qualities are concretized, like sadness. Sadness is an abstract quality, right? You can't see it, you can't feel it, you can't touch it, but you can only feel it. So sadness is treated like a commodity, and sadness was actually manufactured. So this abstract quality is treated like a concrete object. Then again, you can have examples of treating categories of phenomena as if they belong to another category, black smoke. Actually, black smoke is gas, but here it is treated like liquid, poured into. Black smoke poured into. Black smoke cannot be poured, but here it is treated like a liquid. Then that is another feature. Then similes are used, black smoke, ruined the buildings that look like broken hearts. It's an example for simile. Then black smoke hung over the city like bad news, again simile. Cast up with cheery stories as the sea was full of glum fish. Again, it's an instance of simile. So many similes are used. So all these create a feeling of atmosphere different from that of an everyday life. You get a different picture here. The place is not, the description is not that of an ordinary place. This place is something different. So you are led to a fairy tale world using these similes and figures of speech. Now, the other stylistic features are use of large number of noun phrases. We have seen many noun phrases used by the author. And the passage uses many noun phrases, prepositional phrases, noun phrases, and most of the noun phrases are part of prepositional phrases. In the country of Alif Bay, against a prepositional phrase, by a mournful sea full of lumpfish, against a prepositional phrase, and with melancholy, with cheery stories, even though they're noun phrases, they begin with a preposition, so we call them prepositional phrases. Then you can again see the use of relative clause for the purpose of post modification, which never seem to get enough of it. Then it is not only giving a new information, it is not only giving information, but also they act like comment providers. Like they provide comment through humorous or ironic means. Again, you have the repetition of construction, parallelism. Sad city, the saddest of cities. These are examples for parallel construction. Saddest of city, a city so ruinously sad that then sadness manufactured, packaged, sent. See, they're all words. Again, black smoke poured out. They are all examples for repetition of constructions. So these are the stylistic features of the passage. Now let us analyze the poetry. The bar she sat in, like burnished throne, burned on the water. The poop was beaten gold. The purple the sails, and so perfumed that the winds were lovesick with them. These lines are taken from Shakespeare's Antony and Cleopatra, Act 2, Scene 2. Lines 196 to 197. Just go through the line, go through the lines and find out the consonants and vowels, dominant consonants and vowels. Let us take the first line. The bash is acting like a burnished throne burned on the water. What are the dominant consonants in that first line? Burr sound. Burr sound. Again. Then which is the next prominent sound? In, burnished, thrown, burned, on the water. Is it a?
No.
I asked you about consonants. N sound. N sound. Right? N sound. N sound. So, what about the second one? The poop was beaten gold, purple the sails. Per sound, right? Per and then we have ler sound also. Gold, purple, sails. Isn't it so? And the last line, so perfumed that the winds were lovesick with them. Look at those words, so perfumed that the winds were lovesick with them. Which all are the dominant consonants? The sound is there, then the sound, that, the, with, them, the sound is again dominant, isn't it so? Now let us see the effect of this consonant. See, the dominant consonant, as you said, it is ber and na. The second line, it is per and la, and the third, it is the and ver. Again, you can see that per and ber closes. Ber is the voiced counterpart of ber, right? Per is voiceless, ber is voiced. Similarly, la and na are continuance. Continuance, do you know what is a continuance sound? It is produced with a partial or complete blockage of airflow. They are called a continuance. La and na are continuance. The airflow is either partially blocked or completely blocked. That is called a continuance. So la and na sounds are continuance. And let us see the effect that they create. When ber is voiced, this is harder in quality, while per is softer. So the barsh, the description of barsh, is in the tone of heavier. It takes a heavy tone. Heavy, it's more solid because the lines uses the voiced sound ber. So we can say that the barsh, the sound of the barsh, or the way the barsh comes out is heavier and it's more solid. And the poop means the rear part of the ship. Then the poop and the sails. Because in the second line, you can see that it uses the voiceless part per. So compared to the second line, the first line sounds more heavier. More heavy and more solid compared to the second line. Because the second line uses the voiceless plosive per sound, right? At the same time, by using the continuance sounds, la and na, the lines get a liquid nature because the continuance can provide liquid nature of the sound. So barge is moving through the sea. So you will get the picture of a barge, which is very heavy in size, which is moving through the sea because the continuance give the quality of water. Clear?
Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, you can see that they give the first part, the use of ber and na in the first part give a glistening quality to the lines, while the second part where we have the use of per and la sound gets a glistening quality, a flowing quality. Again, you have seen the use of dental fricative the and labiovelar approximant ver. That also, those sounds are used to bring about an effect of fusion of fantasy and reality. Because ver sound is used to show the idea of togetherness or vastness. Again, the sound is often used to show the reality. It is this, that, there, these. Hello.
Hello. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we have seen that the vowels and diphthongs are also used, and the vowels and diphthongs used here are mainly friend sounds or central sounds. Do you remember the friend vowels and back vowels and central vowels? Which all are the friend vowels? E, E, A, A, and also central vowels? A, A, A. See, they are all unrounded vowels. Unrounded vowels means vowels which are pronounced with flat lips. They are unrounded vowels. But back vowels are also used. Only three back vowels are used. Which all are the three back vowels which are used?
O.
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 O. Let us like take the lines one more time. Look at the burnished throne O sound. Again, even though it's a vowel, you can take it as a diphthong, because in diphthongs also we use this O sound, right? Throne, gold. Again, we get a combination of A and O. O is a back vowel, right? Yes. Is O a back vowel?
Yes, ma'am.
Ah, then you get a you get the combination of back vowels in certain lines. Throne, gold. Again, the bar she sat in like a burnished throne. We have a back vowel there. O. Then burnt on the water. Again, on doesn't use O sound. Rather, since it is unstressed, we can say that it uses A sound. Burnt on the water. Water uses O sound, which is a back vowel. The poop was beaten gold. Again, gold uses the diphthong O, just like in the word throne. Own gold. Purple the seals and so perfumed that. Perfumed. Again, you have a back vowel there. Which is the back vowel?
O
sound. Perfumed that. The winds were lovesick with them. So we have three back vowels, right? One is O. It's a combination of it's a diphthong. Then we have O sound in water. Then, O sound in perfumed. So, isn't it so? So, we got three back vowels. Yes, ma'am. All the rest are friend vowels and central vowels. So, what is the quality that these vowels give? Or what is the sound effect that these vowels attribute to the lines? Again, you can see that they're all rounded, so it gives a rhythmic effect, or it gives a musical effect to the lines, because the rounded vowels stand out against a strong background of vowels produced with spread leaves. That means friend vowels and central vowels. So strength is given by using three back vowels, because the three vowels stand out from the rest of the vowels. So that's why that's how you get a glory of the both, because these three back vowels stand out. That's how you get the glory of a both. So you can feel the glory of the both through the use of these vowel sounds. Only three back vowels are used. Is idea clear? They stand out. So similar, just like how this ship or how this bar stands out in the sea. Is it clear? Is that clear? Yes, so this poem uses a lot of friend and central vowels, but it uses only three back vowels. So these three back vowels are used to give strength to the lines, so that it can give effect of glory to the barge. Again, you get the description of a boat, which is a surface level meaning, and the deeper meaning is the boat, the glory of the boat. Then its various parts, they are indirectly not just describing, it's not actually describing the beauty of the boat, rather it describes the person who is sitting in the boat. Who is the person sitting in the boat? It is none other than Cleopatra. So the boat is described to get our attention to the person who is sitting in the boat or the barge, who is an exotic creature. Okay, so she is very feminine, and all these ideas are being suggested using the sounds, vowels and consonant sounds. Clear? Because again, just like how you use back vowels to give strength to the picture, we have the person sitting there who is an exo, who is a very unique creature, who is a very beautiful person, that is Cleopatra, who is also, who also stands out among the barge. Is the idea clear? Hello.
Yeah,
this is how you analyze a poem. So now you know how to analyze a passage and how to analyze a poem. I think we'll stop here. Then you have many examples of passage analysis and poem analysis in your text. Do you have any doubt? I'll send the PDF. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Anything else you want me to ask me? Anything else you want me to explain?
Ma'am. Yes. M command.
You want me to explain M command?
Yes.
You want to see the PPT or can I just explain what is M command?
I didn't understand it.
M command, see, earlier we have seen the connection between the aunt and niece using C command.
Yes.
Now we are going to go to the next further level. Thereby we see the connection between this niece and aunt.
Niece and aunt.
Aunt.
Okay.
Suppose you are taking the sentence as a whole and that you then you divide the sentences, the noun phrase and the, usually you divide it as the noun phrase and the verb phrase.
Yes.
Now we have seen that it is not the verb that gives case, but it is the inflectional element. That can be the tense. Okay.
Okay.
So we are dividing the second part, second branch as the inflectional phrase, IP. That
yes, ma'am.
Inflectional phrase is the maximal production is I or the main branch, the I sochim. Take for example, I sochim, it's a sentence which I'm going to divide as I, the noun phrase, and sochim, which is the inflectional phrase.
So did see, did.
Did plus see is so. So I'm again going to divide the second branch as inflection plus verb phrase. Inflection is did plus verb phrase is see. Then C will again be divided as A, determiner plus man. That's how the division goes. Okay?
Okay.
Now, the connection between this inflection and the noun phrase is called M command.
Okay, ma'am.
Is it clear? Because both of them should be the branches from the same node. Here, the inflectional, the larger, the maximal production is the inflection, that in the whole sentence. That is taken as the IP. I dash is the next projection. So from that projection, we have the elements I and verb phrase. So this I can govern the noun phrase.
Yes, ma'am.
This connection is called M command.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, clear? See, when I send the PPT, you will understand because there are examples and branches.
There's a confusion between C command and M command.
M command.
Now it's clear.
Okay. Any more questions?
Ma'am, can you please share your phone number so that we can contact you in case of doubt, ma'am?
I have already given you my number. Okay, I'll give you again 944-63-64-351.
Thank you, ma'am.
Did you get that? Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
In case
ma'am, when would be the next class?
Sorry?
Next class, when would be that?
I think our classes are over. This is the ninth class. I finished all the portions.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
9446364351. Okay, ma'am. This is your last
This
class?
Is the last block. This is my last class.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Ma'am, thank you very much for all the efforts.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.
No, it was a wonderful class. Really, it was quite a helpful in this pandemic.
Thank you so much.
We are not from your RC, but still you took pains and you, like, we understood the basic concept and everything. I'm from Maharashtra. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, I'm glad to hear that.
Bye.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Take care.
You can watch them anytime. Okay, no problem.
So much.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.